Now that was some shit. You are listening to another episode of the Red Norwegian Manchester United podcast. I am your host, Big Mula, and I really did not want to make this episode. I was fuming after the game. So I ran home, being prepared to just jump on the fucking podcast and just start rambling, because that is one of the most insane games I've watched in my life. And I've seen a lot of weird results with United, win or lose. But that was just some of the weirdest. I have never seen us come from that of a, from such a secure place to just falling totally apart. Even Ferguson's last game, which ended 5-5, and we had the, I think we had a 5-2 lead, but still that didn't feel like such a complete meltdown as what we experienced at the end of the game today. It was, and it's so fucking weird to think about when you think about how it all started with the game. Everybody was flying high, thinking of the QPR game. We came off a good result. I predicted a 3-0 victory. Sorry, I just ate. Everybody was flying high and feeling good, and there was this vibe that we were really gonna take them on now. Some of my friends and even myself and a lot of other fans were prepared for the eventuality of it may not go as well as we hoped, thinking that with the knowledge that Leicester has done reasonably well in their season start and have actually done the best out of the newly relegated, or not relegated, but yeah, the new teams in the Premiership. So we knew that it could be a tough game. But with the way the game started, and things being a little sluggish at the start, but we were pushing, and then Falcao comes, he gets the ball, he goes on the side, he looks up, he sees Van Persie, he lobs it in, a perfect ball, and Van Persie just boom on the head after 12 minutes. Just a perfect setup, a perfect finish, even though it went off the shoulder, I think, of the defender. It was still a good Van Persie-like goal, and Falcao got his first assist, which I thought was kind of funny, because I thought Di Maria would first get his assist, then a goal. And Falcao, I thought he would get the goal before he got the assist, but it went the other way. And Falcao, I think, did great, actually. I think he's without a doubt the best of our attackers at the moment. If you don't want to count Di Maria. So, we got the first goal. Few minutes later, Rooney and Di Maria does some play. Rooney gets the ball. He passes it up to Di Maria at the just before the 16-yard line, and Di Maria just chips it—the most beautiful chip I've seen in not forever, but at least in United's team is probably the best chip I've seen since Welbeck's in the first game of last season. And after that, I felt we were safe, which was probably what the team felt as well. But I felt that we would pull this through, but of course, like a second later, Leicester kicks off, pulls the fucking FIFA glitch, runs down the side, Rojo failed to hold his man and lost him, so he gets all the way down to the line, lobs in the ball, in the back, I don't remember who scored the first goal. After shit went to hell, I tuned out most of the game. I just erased most of it from my mind. So maybe I should have done it straight away when I got home, but I thought I would just calm down a little bit because it's not the end of the world. It's been a good round to lose in, as it turns out. City just played 1-1, almost lost to Chelsea. Liverpool's lost, Tottenham's lost. Arsenal, I think, is the only one of the big players who won. So it's not that bad if you look back on it. It was just in the moment, the shock. But yeah, we got the second goal and things were looking well. We were attacking. We had chances. Falcao was trying to get his goal. Everything was nice. And then, of course, things have to just... I don't know. Second half, we come out. We play well the first, like, 10 minutes. The first 10 minutes, 10, 15 minutes, it's okay. Falcao has a shot that goes in the crossbar. We just had a good momentum going all the way up to the 60th minute where Ander Herrera gets on the end of a ball. I've actually forgotten how he scored. So, how about that? But at least he scores, and now I really feel safe. Now I really feel like we're going to pull this through. There's no reason to think any different. And then, ladies and gentlemen, we come back to... It's not my biggest pet peeve in football, but I know it's a lot of people's, and that's the fucking referee. The decisions made in this game... had a lot to do with how the result ended up to be. I agree with Van Gaal when he said after the game that Rafael had no, he didn't need to go back and sort of get his revenge on the first player or on the player that that tackled him. God damn it, these fucking names. But he got tackled first, and he got tackled a lot harder. So I don't understand. We should have had that free kick. And had we gotten the free kick, they wouldn't have gotten the penalty. Hadn't they gotten the penalty, Cambiasso's goal wouldn't have meant as much, the 3-3 goal. It wouldn't have given them the... It wouldn't have made us collapse the way it did, basically. Because after the Cambiasso goal... It was over for us. Di Maria and Falcao was taken off. What I hear, it's because of they were just tired. They're probably not totally adjusted to the league yet. So rather take them off early and they don't get them injured. But our back line just did not work after that point. It just failed on every single point. I didn't really pay much attention to Marcus Rojo for whatever reason. I got a sneaking suspicion that Rojo is going to be one of those players that I only see the good stuff in and sort of tune him out when he does bad stuff. So when I get through with a game, I'm usually like, "Oh, Marcus Rojo did good," so, and everybody else will be like, "Well, didn't you see he failed that tackle? He failed this. He did that wrong pass. He did that." So. And he did that today. He was not very good and not very dominant like we need him to be. Tyler Blackett had an okay game for the most part. I sort of agree with his decision to go in for the late tackle. Just out of frustration. Because at that point of the game, it wouldn't have mattered. We wouldn't have gotten another goal. It would not happen. You can say all you want that it would have been 4-4. But we had no forward drive at that point. And we should have had a free kick. Tyler Blackett should have had the free kick before. And I don't... It comes to a point where even me... who loves the randomness of the game, who loves that some decision works, some decisions don't, that, you know, it makes the game more random, I'm starting to run out of excuses for not starting to use videos or cameras for these kind of situations, because we've had, United have had, and I'm not saying that this only happens to United, it's just that I follow United the most. I know it happens to other teams all the fucking time, and it's beginning to become a real problem, because it's very important points that are at stake. And I even lost my train of thought now. I'm so fucking annoyed with this whole thing. I was talking about referees, and yeah, and basically they suck. We have all these decisions that are wrong that ends up being essential for game results, and it's starting to fuck with the whole football economy, because clubs are losing out on money awards that they should have had if they have gotten the results they deserved. I'm not saying that every decision should be checked by a fucking a video machine on the side. But for every decision where the other team feels it's necessary to fucking raise an or make an issue out of it, it should be done. I feel so many penalties and free kicks and offside decisions and stuff like that that could or could have been goals that weren't, and wrong goals that were goals that shouldn't. A lot of all of this stuff could have been just removed from the game, at least at the very most important points. Like in the Champions League against Real Madrid a couple of years ago, if we could have had some video reffing or whatever the word is on the Nani situation, he might not have gotten the card. We might have actually won the game. Who knows how far we would have gone if we've actually won that game, because we were on a good roll. We actually deserved to win that game all the way up to that point, just like we deserved to win that game all the way to the 60th minute today. I am not worried about what's coming or the future. I think Van Gaal will look at all the problems, all the backlashes, everything that happens. He looked very confused and even slightly pissed at his interview today, so I think the players are really, really gonna get it now. Rooney, since he's the captain, he's my preferred choice, and that's only that, and it annoys me that he's become so kind of untouchable because of the captaincy ban. Because both he and Van Persie both need to get their shit right and get it right soon. They are not. Welbeck was sold because he was not up to the level of Robin Van Persie and Wayne Rooney, and now they aren't either. Radamel Falcao, when he gets truly into the team, I'm guessing by the next game or the game after that, he's going to start delivering goals. He already started today, just not himself. He's going to be great. He's going to come good. It is our defense that is needing the most. We need new players basically on the back line. Some real competition for Smalling and Jones and Evans, who keeps getting injured all the fucking time. So even if they play well, we need a couple of real class players who can back up for them. I'm sorry, but Michael Keane isn't enough, and he's not even at the club right now. So we need to back up there. And on our attacking side, where we, I agree that we are kind of top heavy at the moment, but if Van Persie and Rooney don't start to deliver and deliver well soon, I think we should consider getting rid of both of them. I love Wayne Rooney, even after all the bullshit, all the stuff that he's pulled, he's been the closest thing that United have had to a mascot. Even when we had Cristiano Ronaldo, he was big enough and good enough to share the limelight. And he's had it by himself since Ronaldo left. Now, Ronaldo, or Angel Di Maria and Falcao is there, and I just wish that he hadn't gotten the captaincy, because that would have given him some real competition. If he didn't perform, he wouldn't be on the team. Right now, the only one I can see that happen to is Van Persie, and that's even harder because he's so close with Van Gaal. I did not agree with them not using Mata today. I would much rather them either taking off Van Persie or Rooney. Because Mata, when you got Herrera and Di Maria and Blin on the field, is just fantastic. When you put Mata out as the substitute for he was the substitute for Falcao, I think. And when you, or was that Yanisai? I think it was Yanisai actually. But when you take Mata and put him in, when you take all the other players out, then he's not good enough to carry the team on his own. Then he's the one who's slowing things down. Like you saw, he lost the ball pretty early and was part of the reason for one of the goals. He's also one of our most prolific scorers, so I think it's time for either Van Persie or Rooney to take the bench for a while. To train hard, to have to fight their way back. Because that's the way we're going to get the real Wayne Rooney, the real Van Persie back, is if they're going to have to earn their spots back. So we need to fill in, we need to do a lot of stuff. This episode, of course, comes a little bit earlier than most, just because I just felt like doing this straight after. I'll probably do another one on Wednesday. And I'll do the preview of the next game there, I think. Or whatever. Whatever it is I do that can be so, to some degree, called a preview. Other than that, man, it's been a good week. It's been a really good week, you know, just enjoying the feeling of that win, of the QPR win. Beginning to feel like United is the team that I fell in love with again. And I actually said, maybe I was the one responsible for things going bad today, but I actually said in the halftime break that this team, the way we play now, we are allowed to lose games. Because that was the problem last year. The problem wasn't that we were losing games, it was how we lost them. And even though it's kind of a problem how we lost the game today, it's not the end of the world when we lose a game, and still, we scored 3 goals. We played extremely well attacking football. We had great chances and opportunities from a lot of different players, and things could easily have gone our way. We need to get tighter at the back, we need to get more focused, we need to be ready to play 90 minutes, not 60, but we're getting there, we're seeing progress. Like I said, the other teams didn't do as well this week either, so the gap up is not that, I don't have the table in front of me, but the gap isn't that big. If we get our regular roll on before everybody else, And we still actually may have a shot for the even the top position. And I'm pretty confident that Chelsea is going to get it this year. I think they're going to basically do what we did 2 years ago and just walk with it. They're most likely, since they've been a complete team from the start and they've played to expectations all the way through. I think they will probably win the league probably a month or something early. But if they don't, if they start to fall or they get a lot of injuries, things don't start playing for them like they have. And we get our team spirit and roll back on with this team. I still believe we can do good against Chelsea, against Manchester City, against all of them. We just need to get the team playing right, and we need to get the back line working. We're gonna need to bring in some more, and sort of the more embarrassing losses we get this year or these next 6 months. It's going to help the board sort of convince, just like the MK Dons game, I bet it kind of made the board feel easier about using the money on both Di Maria and Falcao. So if things doesn't really work out after the philosophy, then we just get some more recruits in January. And then we get Cristiano back this summer, hopefully. We're not far off from being that great team again. And like I've said before, we've earned this money. It's not given to us or anything. So it's ours to spend, and we can spend it in good conscience. We're not selling our soul or our team or anything. Blackett is going to get plenty of chances now that he got the red card. Shaw's probably going to get his debut next weekend. And we got a lot of good stuff to look forward to. We do. Things ain't as pale as they might seem. So, oh, man. I was so hoping I was going to be happy today and just like, yeah. It's just not. We're just not quite there yet. But I am feeling the devil is awakening again. It's happening. It's going to happen soon. I started a new podcast this week, actually, called The Midnight Toker, which is the first episode is sort of a review thingy of the Psycho movie series. Because if you didn't know already, I'm sorry, I'm a nerd of many things, and among those things, movies and games. So, the pod is called The Midnight Toker. It should be up on iTunes pretty soon, so you can check that out. You can add me on @mula85. Contact me, ask me questions, just use hashtag AskTheNorwegian or something like that. I'll try to answer your questions, and I guess I'll talk to you all on Wednesday. And to everybody who is listening, I've just done this for a very short while, and I have not any real numbers, but I've seen that some people are actually listening. So I want to thank each and every one of you who are taking your time to listen to me, and I'm trying to get better, trying to get content out. So look out for the next episode of the Red Norwegian in a couple of days' time. A new Midnight Toker should be out anytime, really. And this has been an episode of the Red Norwegian Manchester United podcast. I am your host, Big Mula. And I'll hopefully see you in a better mood next time. Peace out. want to end this real quick with a couple of shout-outs to my MUFC family. We're talking the Red Card Live podcast with Jack Smythe. We're talking the fucking Reserves, Rantcast, Full-Time Devils, Manc Union, all of them. Keep the podcast coming, and I'll see y'all later.